anxiety, then I thought it was about depression. Anxiety, on the other hand, is very different in that anxiety can be a separate illness. It can go with depression, and usually depression and anxiety go together. If you're depressed, you get anxious. And if you're anxious, you definitely go into depression. Definitely, matlab, at a certain percentage of the time. 25-30% of the population has anxiety. And India, by the way, as she had pointed out, India has the highest statistics for suicide. In depression, the worst case scenario is suicide, also suicide planning suicide. And Bangalore has the highest statistics for all.
You said capital or
something. It was a study by the Britishers. I think it was an article in the British Journal of Psychiatry, but Imran's guys got very upset saying you've done it all wrong. But I think it's kind of true. I think it's true.
And it addresses a larger section of the younger people.
And we are very young.
Not the higher upper bracket, right? It's the lower age bracket for younger.
20s and 30s. So I talked about anxiety. It's a feeling of unease, it's a feeling of fear, it's a feeling that I'm not accomplishing something I'm supposed to be good at. So that's like very basic definition. And I'll just give you an example, okay? 25-year-old comes to the, a woman, comes to the psychiatrist's office with her mother. She looks embarrassed and tense, and she says, you know, the cardiologist sent me to you. This happened. He said, I don't need to see him. And you see you. All my tests are perfectly fine. I've done all the labs in the last 3 months. But in the last few months, every single day, out of the blue, I'm just sitting and doing my thing. My heart starts beating fast. I can't breathe. My hands start shaking. I start having palpitations. And I start sweating. It's very embarrassing. So everybody must be noticing what's wrong with ma'am. You know, she's like behaving like a bunny or something. You know, like shaking, ma'am's hand is shaking, she's holding the papers, it's shaking, she's not breathing, her voice is tremulous. And of course, the woman thought she's having a heart attack. You know, because you feel like you can't breathe, you're choking. And of course, you go to the everybody runs to the cardiologist. Slightly less stigmatizing, you know. Not a mental health issue, I'll go to the cardiologist. And the cardiologist promptly says, everything has been done. It's not my issue. Go see the mental health doctor. And they're like, really? Repeated attacks of fear, feeling out of control, intense worry when the next attack is going to happen, avoiding places where people can see you have this panic attack. This is a panic attack. It is a form of anxiety disorder. Because anxiety disorder is not a single thing. It's multiple, and I'm not going to go through all of them today. I just go through two of them. It is a symptom. This is a panic attack. It's very common. 10-20% of the population.
Lack of oxygen.
Yeah, so it's not really lack of oxygen. It's a kind of fear that has started you into a physiological cycle. Actually, your heart is fine now. You should, of course, not have, you know, heart problems, and you should not be having a heart attack.
But some physical problems create
Let's say
we went to a mental health was directed to a mental health person, and you are studying, and then they found that
so of course we should clarify, is this a real physical issue, is the issue not coming from just psychiatric? Usually this stuff is cleared by the ENT doctor, cleared by the cardiologist, the cardiothoracist. Go ahead and see at least a medical doctor, let's do a basic ECG, check your pulse, check your blood pressure. Even if that's not showing up anything, and you know, then there will be
data.
Should I go on then to the next one?
Yeah.
So just to understand, I'll give you another one. I had this 30-year-old woman from IIM Ahmedabad. And she came to my office saying that I'm terrified when somebody tells me there's going to be a party. I'm very terrified when I have to do a presentation. You know, a lot of you run companies, do your own thing. And this woman said, every time I have to do something, I'm a mess for days and days and days. I'm like stressing about it. Although I'm prepared, I've got everything set. I'm smart, obviously. And yet, I go into this panic kind of mode. I'm fearful, and when I get on stage, my voice is shaking, it's embarrassing, I don't know what to do. And I go on for weeks and days, before the event were like a total, you know, a ball of mess. And so that is something called social anxiety. That means when you know you have to face people, you are of the belief that someone's going to judge you. Or someone's, not that you think people are talking about you in a paranoid kind of way, that's a different disease. But you think that people are going to say, "Iska dress itna achha nahi hai, look at how she's dressed, your joote dekho, last fashion ke hai." Something, you know, and this really bothers you. It bothers you to a point where you don't want to attend this function. And you're not the life of the party, you're the guy standing in the corner, girl standing in the corner, chup-chup, ek drink pakad ke. You know, you don't want to do anything else because you know people are going to be lost, people are going to judge. And that is very difficult if you want to progress in life. Because you're expected to perform. Woman or man, you have to perform. And this gets in the rest of this is social anxiety. And it's very important to be aware. I mean, and most people think, I'm not trying hard enough. I'm not doing enough. Even depression, people say, I'm not trying hard enough. And they try harder and harder, and the thing is that it doesn't get better, no? If it had to get better, it would get better. You've done everything you can. You're leading a healthy lifestyle. Yet it's not happening. And then people start to feel really low because they're trying so hard. So the social anxiety, very anxious about being around people, hard time talking to them, very self-conscious, very afraid people will judge them, and then worrying for weeks on end. I'm going to give you another one which is super common, and then I'll move on to what can you do. I know one more that I really want to talk about because it's happened so often recently, I worry about it. So I'm going to bring up two more anxiety things. One is that I always thought I was just a worrier. I feel keyed up and unable to relax. At times it comes and goes, at times it's there all the time. I have a terrible sleeping problem. There are times when I wake up wired in the middle of the night. I have trouble concentrating, reading the newspaper. Sometimes I feel a little lightheaded. And these muscles are always tense. I find I'm always doing this, stretching, yay, go. And I'm never, you know, the laid back, take it easy, haan, kal. We are going to Greenland, nothing is packed. Haan, kar lenge. I'm the kind that weeks in advance needs to keep it all set. And that's called generalized anxiety disorder. That's another anxiety, super common, again, 20-30%. And these are people who kind of, other people want to maybe not be around too much. Because the energy of these people is so stressful, they seem hyper. They just need to know everything organized. Yes. Not in a obsessive, compulsive kind of way, but they just too stressful to any other people. So they worry about everything. They find it hard to know these. See, you have to understand, nobody wants to be miserable. I mean, unless somebody in this room who likes being miserable, you know. So nobody really wants to be feeling like crap. So imagine if you're worrying all the time and it just doesn't seem to go away. So that's the part that you have to identify the difference between somebody who's just worrying about two or three things and somebody constantly worrying. I'm a constant worrier. I worry about everything. Drives me nuts.
What about the kids, Sabina?
I have that part. I'll bring up a couple of things and then we'll go to that. I'll just bring up two pieces of evidence that is out there about women and children. And I don't know the age range of women here. I was going to ask you before we started. I mean, these are, I think the varied range from 30 plus.
So anybody lower than 30, 25 and above.
So somebody might have no kids, somebody might have some kids, somebody might have kids that are abroad and all done married also. So that's also possible. So I'm obviously not going to talk really much about the women whose kids are married and gone away. You know, it's more now of an emotional, biological link rather than you need to worry about their studies or their diet. And that brings you to the menopause. But I'm going to talk about the women who have actually got children that are currently under their care, which is a little more complex. Isn't there a lot of data, and it's not Indian data. By the way, none of the data that we have is really Indian. Our research is not very translational because for many reasons we don't have enough funding for it. Our population is very varied. You want to do a study, it's very easy if you have a homogeneous. Everybody looks the same, everybody talks the same, slight variations. We don't have that in India. Right from language onward, there will be a difference. It's very hard to do research in India. And of course, there's not enough money. But the research is coming out of Britain and US that some people think that a good mother is one who gives up work to stay home with her children. There is no scientific evidence that says children are harmed when their mothers work. So as far as evidence goes, there is no evidence that if you are a working mother in whatever form, your own company or you work with somebody, that because women, I think being a woman is equal to being guilty. So just to at least be aware that the evidence doesn't say that if you are a working mother, you are not a good mother. A child's development is influenced more by the emotional health of the family, how the family feels about the mother working, and the quality of child. So you obviously have to have a buy-in from your in-laws or your parents or your whoever you live with. It's helpful. Obviously, there's going to be strife in the house. It doesn't matter whether you're working or not working mother. If there's strife in the house, please be aware that this will definitely lead to some sort of emotional issues with the child, whether we're working or not. So it's more to do with the health of the family rather than the mother working. That's just the side thing. So the bigger thing we as women need to focus on is how do we live in houses that are mostly stable, where people usually get along. That's what we need to focus on. That means we get some buy-in from the men. Get them to contribute. Get them to at least do chota mota thing. If not with you, with your children. All of that will help. And then, a child who is emotionally well-adjusted, well-loved, well-cared for will thrive regardless of whether the mother works outside the home. So again, it brings, this is all evidence out there. It's not my own theory. You know, this is stuff that they've researched, at least abroad, and they said, see, if the mother and if the household is kind of, see, for a woman who wants to work, if you say, ghar mein baitho, it's immediately going to create a certain amount of discomfort and sort of sadness in her, and that will slowly start to impact. And in time, when the kids leave home, you've not worked in 10 years, you're like, abhi kaise jaun wapas, you know, the field doesn't need somebody who's outdated as me. So all these things come in. But that requires a pretty sophisticated man to understand, you know, all of this. Now if you choose to live at stay at home for your children, I mean the evidence doesn't say stay at home mothers are bad mothers. It doesn't say that. The converse is not true. It just says working doesn't mean you're a bad mother. And be aware. Something, there's a lot of evidence which I had in other talks where mothers who work outside the house, manage a home, manage your children, whatever age they are at, even married children, when you provide children of such mothers actually see what the mother is capable of. They see that she's multitasking. They see she's efficient. They see that she's able to do all these things and yet keep going. That's a good example.